morning. My name is Lauren Neri, and I'm reading William Faulkner's address accepting the Nobel Prize in Literature, originally delivered in Stockholm in December 1950. He was a writer who won this award for his powerful and artistically unique contribution to the American novel. Ladies and gentlemen, I feel that this award was not made to me as a man, but to my work, a life's work in the agony and the sweat of the human spirit, not for the glory, but to make out of the material of the human spirit something which was not there before, so that this award is only mine in trust. It will not be hard to find a dedication for the money part of it, commensurate with the purpose and significance of its origin. But I would like to go to the same with the acclaim too, by using this fine moment as a pinnacle from which I may be listened to by young men and young women already dedicated to the same anguish and travail, among whom who may someday stand where I stood this afternoon. Our tragedy today is a general and universal physical fear, so long sustained that we can even bear it. There are no longer questions of the spirit. There is only one question: when will I be blown up? Because of this, the young man and young woman writing today has forgotten the problems of the human heart, and conflict with itself alone can make good writing, because that is only worth writing about, and worth the agony and the sweat. He must learn them again. He must teach himself that the basest of all things is to be afraid. And teaching himself that, forget it forever, leaving no room in his workshop for the old verities and truths of the heart, the old universal truths lacking which any story is evermore and doomed: love and honor and pity and pride and sacrifice. Until he does so, he lives under a curse. He writes not of love, but of lust, of defeats in which nobody loses anything of value, and of victories without hope, and worst of all, without pity or compassion. His griefs grieve no universal bones, leaving no scars. He writes not of the heart, but of the glands. Until he relearns these things, he will write as though he watched the end of man. I decline to accept the end of man. It is easy enough to say that man is immortal simply because he will endure. That is when the last ding-dong of doom has clanged and faded, and from the last worthless rock hanging tideless in the red and dying evening, that even there will be one more sound, that of his puny, inexhaustible voice still talking.